Hey guys, my name is Katarina Berry. I'm an empath and I am challenging myself to do 30 days of videos talking about who we are as empaths, what are some of the challenges that we experience, what are some of our special abilities, and how to integrate all of that into the real world. So yesterday I did my very first video and it talked about relationships and the struggles that I've had as an empath with intimate romantic relationships and how I've dealt with them. So today I want to talk about something completely different. I want to talk about eye contact. So just a little bit of a backstory. I grew up in Moscow, Russia until the age of 15 when I moved to the United States. Growing up as a tiny child, I was very shielded and protected and kind of always surrounded by family, loved ones, parents, my grandma, and I was never really kind of alone in the public, never really had to travel by myself. And that didn't really change when I went to school, but the amount of travel that I started doing on a daily basis, using public transportation, going across Moscow, which is a giant city, and also encountering a lot of strangers on the public transportation, at the bus stations, on the subway, at school, my peers, teachers, and just again random strangers on the street. So I began having these very bizarre experiences that I would never really talk about because I could not really quite explain them. I did not understand them myself very well either. So what started happening was while taking, say, a ride on the bus or riding a metro subway, I would come across someone's pair of eyes. I would make eye contact with a stranger. It's usually always would be a total complete stranger. And sometimes nothing really would happen. But sometimes I would have these very bizarre, dark, very draining, very depressing experiences when I would make an eye contact with someone and all of a sudden, and again, I wouldn't really understand what's going on, I wouldn't really know how to explain it, all of a sudden I would be brought into this world of suffering, of trauma, of darkness. And it was devastating. And again, the other kind of part about that devastation was that I had absolutely zero idea of how to put this into words because there is no logical way to describe this experience. But what began happening was I started noticing that some people were seeking to make eye contact with me. Like they were seeking to share this dark space, this, again, very hard to describe, this world of suffering that I thought they were in. And as soon as I would kind of make that contact, as soon as our eyes would meet, I would be just submerged into their energy, into their experiences. And as a child, as a little girl, I didn't really know what these experiences even were. I didn't understand. I was fortunate to have a very happy childhood, very loving family. And a lot of this darkness that I experienced was completely new to me. It was unlike anything that I've seen interacting with people that were either my parents' friends or relatives. And it was very disturbing to me. And a lot of times after these public transportation experiences, I would just be very depressed. I would feel very drained, very unhappy, very frustrated, very abused. And there was no way to describe that because nothing would happen except for eye contact. So another thing that began happening was at school, I would have these experiences with my peers and with teachers as well. And so I would see, for example, what is happening in the life of, say, another kid that's in my class, and perhaps they had abuse at their home. And again, there was no exchange of words that would indicate that. They would not tell me, hey, listen, this is going on, this is what's going on at my house, this is what's going on with my family. I would just be able to get that information from eye contact with them. And it was a very isolating experience because I felt very weird and out of place. I didn't know how to really communicate with my peers because I didn't really grow up, I didn't go to like pre-K, I didn't go to any kind of like kid socials or anything like that. I was pretty much limited to communicating with, again, my family members. And so I didn't really have that much of social skills going into school to begin with, but these experiences were even more isolating because I didn't know how to address what I was seeing, and I also couldn't ignore that. So just by making eye contact, I would get all of this information that was not shared with me in any traditional normal way, and I was very aware of that. I'm a pretty logical person. I was a pretty logical child, and so I was understanding that there is nothing that's shared with me that would indicate the information that I'm getting from just eye contact. However, it was impossible for me to ignore that information. So I didn't really know how to talk to these kids because I was aware of so much more than they would share with me. So another thing that began happening with teachers whom I would interact with more frequently than strangers on the train, I began seeing their lives as well, again, through eye contact. I began understanding where they're coming from, who they are as a person, what their personality is like, what they like in terms of social communication, what is their communication style, what can influence them in a way. And so it was pretty strange as well, because some of this information you wouldn't be able to gauge normally as a kid. It was more kind of a more like a developed level of consciousness that you would have to have and have like adult conversations with them to get that understanding. But I was able to get that through just eye contact. And so I kind of started using that. That was a way for me to perhaps often even manipulate circumstances in my favor. So I was able to say, like, become a teacher's pet because I would gauge what that person enjoys, what they like to hear, what they like in life, what are their interests, what are their hobbies. Like, not specifically in these terms, but I would just, it was just kind of like a momentary awareness that I would get, and then I wouldn't lose that. And I just kind of tried playing on that. I would kind of start incorporating that into my communication style, just the way that I approach them, the way that I behaved in class. I would adjust that style to each specific teacher. And so that gave me an advantage often. And I can say that in a way that can be unfair because, again, none of this information was shared with me in any traditional means of communication, not through speaking, not through writing, not through show and tell. It was just something I was able to download, so to speak, without any effort, without anything other than eye contact. But meanwhile, as the years went on, my isolation from my peers kind of heightened. Because I didn't know how to ignore what I would see about their family life, about their behavior of their parents, or whatever was going on, and when it was traumatic or dark or hard for me to understand or explain, I would just really isolate. And I didn't really have that many social skills, again, with peers. With teachers, it was a little weird and different because I kind of gauged their communication style, and I would just kind of mirror that, and that worked in a lot of cases. So that even more so, I would say, isolated me from my peers because I would be a very awkward kid in talking to my, say, classmates, but with teachers, I would get along really well, and I would maybe get some favors, or, you know, if I made mistakes, these would be overlooked because the teacher liked me, and most teachers liked me because I would mirror each of the teachers' individual communication style to them. So it was a strange dynamic. But what started happening on these public transportation trips as the years went on is I gained this awareness that somehow these people that were seeking eye contact pretty aggressively, that had this kind of unexplainable darkness, the stuff that they just kind of wanted to like dump on someone, it started kind of appearing to me that they were somehow able to tell that I'm gonna be able to get all that, like, this read from them. So they would very aggressively seek my eye contact. It was so strange. It was nothing I ever really brought up or mentioned to anyone because I had no way of explaining it. But it's like there was something about me that gave off that vibe that I'm like a good target to dump all of that stuff onto because I am very sensitive to that. And so I would have very strange experiences with, and again, I always traveled with at least one of my family members because my parents and my family did not think it was safe for me to travel alone because at the times I was growing up in Moscow, it really wasn't that safe most of the time. And we really couldn't afford any other means of travel other than public transportation. So usually I would be chaperoned by an adult. So even though that was the case, I would have people purposefully position themselves across from me or try to get on my eye level somehow, and it would get bizarre to the point where I realized that I needed to guard my eyes. Like, I needed to avoid eye contact with certain people that exhibited these behaviors at all costs. And so I started doing that. I started just averting my eyes. I started looking in any possible direction I could just to not look at that person who was seeking eye contact with me in this public environment. And often it would get really strange to where I would be looking in any and every direction possible, and the person would go out of their way to like still get an eye contact with me. As I'm telling this, I'm getting goosebumps. It's a very bizarre thing to share. I know to a lot of people it's not gonna make much sense, but if you're an empath and you've experienced people purposefully seeking eye contact with you that had stuff, like, because here's the thing, even if you're not an empath, here's the thing, what happens when you make an eye contact with a person, it's an invitation to start communicating. Say you're walking down the street, you make an eye contact with a stranger, you usually either smile or you say hi or you somehow acknowledge them. Once the eye contact is made, it's the first step towards communication. Whether it be verbal or nonverbal, whether it be a gesture or a nod or some, or like again, a smile, it's the first step that then, you know, after you made that eye contact, it's very unusual that you just look away and ignore the person. How often does that happen? Not very often, unless you're offended by someone, unless someone's being aggressive, or you just get this kind of like feeling that, you know, they're not being friendly. Then it's natural to look away. I wanna kind of transition into the present day in the United States. I have to say that although I don't have these experiences where someone's seeking eye contact to kind of dump this energy of darkness and heaviness and deep frustration and anger and negativity on me, I've often had times where I would purposefully avoid eye contact as means of not engaging with someone who seems either very intoxicated or possibly aggressive, or someone soliciting, say, money on the street in a pretty aggressive way, or someone trying to hit on me, which I don't want to engage with, or someone being, you know, again, intoxicated and stupid at a bar or on the street in a crowded bar populated area. That has happened many times. But I have to say that eye contact for me, beyond these experiences, I, as an adult, as an empath, as throughout my life, as a child, as an adult, throughout all of my life, I find it to be very energy consuming. So it's very important for me to share eye contact with the person that I'm talking to, because that allows me to read them. That allows me to get that empath read. That I think is one of the biggest gifts that I have as an empath, is the ability to feel a person's emotions, ability to, I use the term hear, but it's not really, it has nothing to do with actual physical hearing, but to be able to comprehend their thoughts without them having to describe their thoughts to me. It's also a very important tool to read if the person is lying, which I'm able to tell in most cases, without, even if a person is a really good liar, I'm just able to get that read. Eye contact has a lot to do with this. If someone is looking away or uncomfortable maintaining eye contact, obviously not like staring all the time, but if there are points where they're avoiding the eye contact, that usually gives a read to me also. There's like some kind of a problem there. Either they're trying to not share something, or they're trying to purposefully avoid talking about something, or they're not being honest. So that is an important way to engage in the conversation that I'm having with someone. But outside of having a conversation with someone, if it's a stranger, if it's a small talk, it's usually extremely draining to me, and it leaves me feeling exhausted. So I'm a pretty extroverted introvert. I do like my time to recharge. I do like my time to have some solitude, to have some time and space to myself. However, when I am out, say networking, attending a networking event where there are many people and I'm trying to make as many connections as possible, of course, eye contact plays a huge role in that. It gets to the point where it becomes almost impossible for me to continue. At first, of course, I'm enjoying it. I like meeting people. I love talking to people. But after a while, it's like I start running on empty. It's like all of my energy gets drained. Why does it get drained? Do I get tired of talking? No, I actually don't. I love talking. I talk way too much. But at the same measure, talking and exchanging verbal or even nonverbal communication through gestures and through ideas and through, again, talking to each other, that's one thing, especially if I know a person. But when it involves meeting many people and doing this eye contact exchange with them, it gets to the point where I am depleted, because it's like I give something of myself when I make that eye contact, and I take something from a person, not take it away from them, but I take on that like information download of who they are, of what they think, of what they feel, of their background, of their elements of their personality. And it takes energy to do that, to get that read. And once I get to the point of having met like 5 or 10 people, it becomes very difficult for me to continue. And often it gets to the point where I go from extroverted to completely introverted in like a split second. And I'm no longer making eye contact with anyone. And I'm kind of to myself. I go find someplace in the corner. And if I have to stay at the event, I kind of like sit it out there and just isolate, or I leave when they have the first opportunity. It can be confusing to some people why that happens. The best way that I can describe it is there is a limit that I of the reads that I can do on people, of the amount of people that I can engage with, especially new people, because meeting a new person involves getting a whole new read, a whole new information download, and it's a lot. It's not just one aspect, it's not just a name, which, by the way, I'm very bad with remembering names, because I'm so consumed by the read of their overall personality, of their thoughts, of their feelings, which, again, I can't really limit that. I can't say, oh, well, with this person, I'm just gonna remember their name and maybe some of their thoughts, and but not their feelings. It's not something that I can control. Once that eye contact happens, I get all of it. And it's like not a selective process by any means. So with all of that information, it's very hard to qualify or quantify, because it's an overall scope of someone's entire personality. That kind of prevents me often from remembering their name, because I can't do the logical memory storage and get that read at the same time. It's the read takes over. So like I'm getting the download anyway, and the person is telling me their name, I can't, my logical mind is not engaged and can't be engaged, because my other area of the mind, I guess more subconscious, is more engaged with this overall download, and it's so massive that it's like impossible to correlate the two. So usually after a little bit of interaction, after I get that read and it kind of settles in, and I kind of I gauge this personality of the person in front of me, I ask them again for their name, and then I'm able to make a point of remembering what that name is and make some associations to help me remember, and then it becomes more natural. But it does not happen for me immediately. I can't do both. So after I get a certain amount of reads, I would say probably max like 10 to 15 people. If it gets to the point where it's like 20 people, 30 people, like that's it. I am just gonna shut down. I'm gonna avoid, it's just a very dysfunctional state for me. And usually I will have to have like a whole day of recovery afterwards, which is pretty crippling because life continues, work continues. You can't just put everything on pause and say, you know, I'm an empath. I need like to, you know, just disconnect from the whole world for like the next 24 to 48 hours. I still have to sometimes, but it's very hard to incorporate into real life, so to speak. But to finalize this video, to me as an empath, eye contact is a lot. It's the entire personality of the person that I make eye contact with. If it's a person I already know, then it's just an update on their personality, their state of mind, their state of emotions, their way of where they are in life and how they feel about that. But if it's a whole new person, it's like getting another, you know, set of software installed. It's not a software update. It's like a whole another user being uploaded onto the computer of my mind, if that's a good way to put that into perspective. And in that process, I almost have to make room for that new person to be downloaded in my comprehension. And it takes a lot. Again, it's very hard to qualify. It's not just someone's name, interests, and ideas. It's their whole entire personality. And it's a lot. And so when it's been negative and unwelcome and aggressive and weird in Russia on these public transportation experiences, it was devastating because I would get this download of a very disturbing life of someone who is trying to get it off their chest to share it with someone. And it's almost like they can sense that I'm a sensitive person in that way, that I'm an empath, and they want to get my eye contact so they can offload themselves onto me. It sounds very bizarre, but that's exactly how I feel as to what happened in these incidents. So that was very overwhelming. So I learned how to avoid eye contact, but it also has served me in ways, again, of people being aggressive or drunk or trying to, you know, hook up with a stranger on the street, as if that works very well, or being mean or soliciting money in a very aggressive way, or soliciting something. That kind of also it became somewhat of a protection instinct. So I, before even making eye contact with someone, a stranger again, it's almost like I get a feeling of whether it's safe or not, just because I've been burnt so many times in these experiences in Russia. It's like I've learned how to tell the intention behind that seeking of eye contact. Interestingly enough, whether you're an empath or not, if you try this, if you are feeling that someone's trying to approach you in an aggressive way, like either they're trying to sell something to you, or they're trying to ask you for money, or they're trying to hit on you, or they're trying to say something angry to you because they're either drunk or frustrated or just whatever, and you're just kind of sensing like, oh, I don't want to have this interaction, but here it goes. Try this. Try not making any eye contact with them. Do whatever it takes. You don't have to say anything. You don't have to be mean. You don't have to be rude. Just do everything you can to not make eye contact. Look away, get up, walk away. Just don't make eye contact. You're gonna be surprised at how effective that is. It will work like magic, because when the eye contact doesn't happen, there is no way to begin the interaction other than violence and someone grabbing you and making you face them. It becomes impossible to start that awkward conversation that you don't want to have. So it might feel awkward doing that, but you're gonna be surprised as to how much energy it will save you in terms of not having to talk yourself out of it or come up with excuses or do the awkward, like, yeah, maybe one day, but I'm not interested right now type of thing. It can feel pretty awkward at first, but if you practice this in situations that are kind of threatening or annoying to you, you're gonna discover how pretty powerful that is. So I've learned the skill of avoiding eye contact to avoid the interaction altogether. But when the eye contact is welcome, when it happens, it's more than just eye contact. It gives me this entirety of this person's personality, their feelings, their thoughts, their background, what's going on with them. It's deeper than knowledge. It's the entirety of who they are. And so when there's a lot of eye contact, it can be pretty exhausting for me as an empath, and I think for other empaths as well. So this is the video that I wanted to make to kind of explain this exchange, because it's more than verbal exchange, it's more than writing a letter, it's more than a phone call, it's more than nonverbal communication of gestures and signs and facial expressions. It's so much deeper than that. And the only organ, the only way that I'm gauging all of this is through eye contact. That's the main source of all the reads that I've ever gotten as an empath on anyone ever in my life, as a child, as an adult, throughout all of my life. It all happens through the eyes. You know, they say eyes are the mirror to the soul. Well, I can kind of attest to that, because whatever your beliefs in terms of what soul is are, doesn't really matter. As an empath, that's where I get the entire person's being, their whole entire self downloaded as to me knowing who they are. And yes, I'm pretty terrible with names, but that's part of the reason why, because I can't even hear the name that's being said. I'm getting their whole entire personality downloaded into my consciousness, and then I know who they are. It's hard to qualify that, but it's like their entire self. I know who they are. So that's the today's video. I hope you guys have enjoyed this. I am doing this 30-day challenge for 30 days. Today's day number 2, and I'm very excited to cover some other topics as well in the forthcoming videos. Thank you so very much for watching. If you have any questions or comments or want to share your own empath experiences or ask me about particular subjects, please comment down below. I am pretty new to YouTube. This is what I'm doing to kind of motivate myself to really get started and produce content daily. So if you want to encourage me and support me, please subscribe. That means the world to me, and that will go a long way. So thank you again. I will see you in the next video, and until then,